not a big deal with that. Everybody called the bottom of the Sundance Film Festival. That's how it was known. But anyway, appreciate the time to be here and thank you for being on. As I mentioned, before preaching, I was involved for years and years as a special effects makeup artist in Hollywood. It's kind of a crazy business. You're making, I never thought I'd ever be able to make money making rubber monsters. And essentially, and then a lot of people ask me, how do you be a Christian? Is it possible to be a Christian in that environment because it has such a reputation that goes with it? But you find good people that are in there. You hear a lot of bad stories with it, but there's also a lot of good ones. And you find people that are, that have high morals, and you just kind of stick together and everything. So it was interesting, though, as I started thinking about going off to school, I didn't ever want to be a preacher. That wasn't my plan. When I moved to Southern California. I grew up in Utah, moved to Southern California, and that's where I met my wife. And so for a long time, I never thought of being a preacher. But then there was a good friend of ours, and he was living in California at the time. He was getting ready to go to Memphis School of Preaching. And so he said, well, why don't you come and do that? And I said, because that's not why I moved here. And so he went off and he did it, but then I started thinking more and more. There's a film in here that sort of got me thinking in that direction, and I'll show that to you in just a minute here. But I just woke up one day and I said, Katie's my wife, I said, what do you think about me going to the Memphis School of Preaching? And she said, well, if that's what you want to do, and I didn't think she was going to be that agreeable to it, and I said, okay. And then I started talking to a lot of people I knew in the industry, and they said, their response was pretty much the same. They said, wait a minute, you want to do what? You're going from doing this for years to doing what? But the one person was really interesting that actually did, he was very, very supportive of it. I did a film, we're on location in St. Louis, and I was working with Gunnar Hansen. If you're a horror movie fan, Gunnar Hansen was the original Leatherface in Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And he hated Hollywood, hated the whole Hollywood LA scene. He lived in Maine, had a house in Maine, and he'd fly in for movies, but then he'd fly right out. But I was doing a film with him and did a lot of effects work with him on this film. And I said, and I called him up and I said, Gunnar, I said, I'm getting out of the business. And he goes, well, what are you going to do? And I said, I'm going to go be a preacher. And he said, that's great. I think that's great. And so I told my wife, I said, hey, Katie, Leatherface thinks it's great. I'm going to be a preacher. So anyway, that's kind of, that's kind of how I got the ball rolling. When you get into makeup effects, is anything in the film industry, a lot of it is feast or famine. And, that's the one thing I don't miss. People ask me all the time, do you miss it? Yes, I miss parts of it, but I never regret what I do now versus what I did then. Making rubber monsters isn't going to get people to heaven. And there are things that are far more important to me than the new film. But having said that, it was a lot of fun and different things. And I'm going to talk about, show you some of the work that I was involved with. And hopefully I can get this done. Maybe? Okay, can we get that? This isn't working with the clicker, so. There we go. Okay. It's kind of dark with the photo here, but this was one of the first films I worked on when I got to LA, and that was the first Pirates of the Caribbean. I came in kind of the end part of most of it had been shot. They were doing some pickup shots and everything, but if you remember the tall black pirate and the kind of the beans that were, the little prosthetic pieces, and I made the prosthetic pieces that went on. This tall actor, and also for Jeffrey Rush, we did a prosthetic nose for him. And so that was the first kind of introduction. I did that film, and I did one. I think it was called Bulletproof Monk, which is kind of a crazy martial arts film. And that was that was a whole intro to the effects scene in Southern California that I did. Now I did a lot of work outside of California prior to that. With it, but that was the first major film that I was able to do it. One more. Okay. There's the next one. Cat in the Hat. How many have seen this film? You're the one, who's the one that likes it? No one likes this movie. No one admits that they like this film. But we did a lot of effects work for Cat in the Hat. We did a big cowl for Mike Myers and also for his photo double. And his photo double is actually a member of the Church of Christ. We got to be really good friends through this. And so they wore the same makeup, and he was always on set with them. But we did this, we did that prosthetic. We worked with a lot of different materials and special effects. Foam latex is one of the main things we worked with. Silicone, gelatin effects, which is just, so foam latex is a really soft, soft material. It doesn't smell the best, though, because you have to bake it. It's almost, you're putting ingredients together, mixing it up, and baking it in a mold that has been sculpted and made to fit that particular actor. And so Mike Myers, there's some interesting stories about Mike. I don't know if I should tell these here, but someone's going to know Mike Myers, and they're going to call him and say, guess what he said about it. He was complaining about the smell of the gloves and the smell of the mask and everything. So one of our effects guys says, hey, let's put Tabasco sauce on the inside of his mask. But it was fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun to at least create the character. Even if the film's not as good as you want it to be. In fact, we went to the test screening. I took my wife to the test screening for the cast and crew. And the director was going around after the film saying, hey, what do you think of this movie? How do you think, I'm going up and down the different aisles. And my wife said, Nathan, you've got to leave before Dead Stars. So some are great. Some like it. The kids love it. Cat and Hat, and they have fun with it, which is good. Okay, there's. Okay, this was the film. This was the film that I worked on with Gunnar Hansen in St. Louis. We did a big blood scene right here, and the scene was called for these townspeople that were attacking this individual, and so we're down here, if you notice, there's plastic over the camera, and they were going to set up a shot where they're shooting up, and they have all these townspeople that have these pitchforks and shovels, and they're just beating someone senseless. It's kind of a post-apocalyptic kind of film, and this, the camera's pointed up, watching the people coming down here, and I'm down on the ground next to the camera, throwing blood up at these people. So it looks like they're just destroying this person that was getting mutilated by all these people. And the only problem was that the director had plastic over him, the camera had plastic on it, and I did not. So I'm just by the end of this a bloody mess that is all over. It was really messy. But it was a fun process. I mean, it's always fun to get into, to doing different things of, making things look differently. That was the film that we did there. It was called The Apocalypse and the Beauty Queen. Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I did a couple of episodes of Buffy, and this is from one of the episodes. How many of you here watched Buffy? We're fans of Buffy. Okay. You might remember this one's called Gnarl. We did a full body suit of this demon kind of character for one of the episodes, and it was a lot of fun. There was different aspects of makeup. Some would be application process, and I've been on set to do application, and then there's also shop work that you do, where you make everything in the shop, and then you just have a couple guys go to set to fit the actor. Fit the actor in the shop, and then you can send them off to set, and then have guys do the touch-ups on them. So you're kind of involved in different parts of the whole process. It just has a mind of its own. This is some different makeups for some different productions. The one in the upper left here was there was a channel that was out several years ago called the Chiller Channel, and it showed all kinds of horror and sci-fi movies and everything. Well, this is one of their TV spots, and the whole concept was this zombie that was trying to win a contest, and he was at his computer obsessed with trying to get in online to do it. So I did the zombie makeup for that, and I had to make a fake hand. Because one of his hands were supposed to have fingers that broke off when he was trying to tie it. And so, create a couple of prop hands and broken fingers and everything for that. In the upper right-hand corner was a movie called Knight of the Templar. That was the last feature-length film that I did before I left to go to Memphis. And I did a lot of it was kind of a fantasy, kind of a dark fantasy involving the Knights Templar. And so I did a lot of battle sequences. I did a decapitated head and a lot of gashes and war wounds and everything for these different knights involved with it. This you can't see, it shows up really dark. It's a werewolf that I did for a film, and then we did a lot of prosthetics for the werewolf, and then teeth for the werewolf. The one in the bottom right was a vampire, and if it showed up clear, it would be a kind of a cracked look, you know, because he was weathered and old, and maybe, you know, how to make him look like he'd been around for years and years and years. The bottom left was for a bomb sequence in a film. It was called The Martyr, and it was a short film, and it's about a bomber, terrorist, suicide bomber that goes into a cafe, and he starts to question his own ethics of why he's doing that, but he ends up blowing up the cafe. It's really kind of a dramatic piece, but anyway, I did a lot of the bomb effects work with it. And so, you know, you're doing everything in makeup. You're making monsters, you're doing gory makeup, you're making people look fat or old, or even skinny and younger. And I think David asked me once, you know, can you make me look younger than what I am? Listen, I'm a makeup artist. They stopped doing miracles a long, long time ago. If I can get the next one. Okay. This was for a TV series called Firefly. Anyone remember Firefly? On for about one season. I think they're bringing it back, but this was for one of the episodes. They come across kind of this cannibalistic race, and we had to do these full bodies that looked like they'd been skinned, and we did it in what is called polyfoam, which is a kind of a harder foam. And then we dressed it with, we painted it up, and then put silicone over the top to make it kind of glisten. And that's what you see in the upper left right here. You see one of the bodies that are hanging that we did. In the upper right, that's me dressing this body right here to make it look like it's been eaten by this alien cannibalistic race, I guess it was. Next one. All right, this was one of the more fun ones. I got to know people from Lucasfilm, and Lucasfilm was working with Disney. It was before Disney took them over, but they did a thing at Disneyland called Jedi Training Academy. And they said, we want to have a Darth Maul character in there. And they said, would you be interested in coming in and making Darth Maul? I said, yeah. This is probably one of the most fun projects that I did outside of film. I have done theater, I've done film, but this was really fun. It's because you get to see him interact with a lot of different people. And that's one of the most fun things you can do, is when you can actually either go to a theater and see the audience reaction to something you did, or live theater, where you can see people respond, live theater, movie theater. This was fun because I can sit in the audience, no one knew who I was because I was behind the scenes, and just watch how he would go up and down and do that with my doing Darth Maul. So, you know, getting to know, Luke, having a relationship with Lucasfilm really helped in getting other projects going as well. Next one. Okay, aside from effects work, from makeup effects, I did some prop work. This was for a movie called The Last Samurai, which was a Tom Cruise movie. And this was all of the samurai swords that were used in the film, we put together. They're made out of polyurethane, which is a really hard kind of plastic. And we had to paint them up and make them look like these samurai swords or fake arrows all over the place. My wife was actually in the film. And she did some background, she had some close-up background work or whatever in the movie, and I wasn't on set for it. We had just made the props and then sent them off. But she called me one day from the set and she goes, "Hey, guess what? Tom Cruise is playing with one of your swords." Okay? That was fun. You see all the different swords that we've made. So there's a lot of different aspects to some of the process for special effects. Next one. All right, this is a film called The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. We did a lot of work on this. You know, a lot of these films that when you work on a big production, like I said, it was, you know, it can be feast or famine. Some of them, you're working for 4 months at a time. You're going in every single day, working long hours, getting, you know, getting the effects made and ready and painted and, you know, getting ready to apply it to the actor, and that's just all the prep work for it. And that League of Extraordinary Gentlemen was one of them. I was actually working on League at the same time as Cat in the Hat. We would jump, and it was coming out of the same shot, and we were jumping from one project to the next. It's been part of the day doing the Cat, part of the day doing League, and, you know, because they were filming it roughly the same time. And so, so the big Mr. Hyde character was really cool. He had a cowl made out of silicone, and then he made these huge arms for him that were full latex. And the actor was, you know, extended beyond, but inside was kind of a handle that the actor would be able to use to open and close the, you know, the big fist that you see. And so he'd wear these big, and these giant arms connected to the bodysuit that we had made for him. And so he was able to move around and, you know, move in different ways and move the arm, you know, open the hand and close the hand, and your fingers were working. You're working with a lot of different cables and animatronics and so forth with a lot of it. We also did the Phantom that was in it, just the lip, which was just kind of a prosthetic piece that we did for him. Next one. Okay, you recognize this? This is probably the thing that got me starting to think about preaching, but it's not for the way that you might think. This is a film called The Passion of the Christ. It was a Mel Gibson movie, and it gained a lot of attention. One of the things that really kind of stuck with me as we were making this film, I was behind the scenes, and all of the last, how many of you here have seen Passion of the Christ? Probably a good, okay. So you remember the scenes where we had all the whip marks, the lashings from head to toe. Every one of those pieces were a separate appliance. So think of how many, we had to make 30 full body sets for him every single day for filming, because it's important for continuity to get everything correct. So we made every single one of these. They had to be applied. He went through hours of makeup with Jim Caviezel, and so, you know, we did this, and then we had to do, you know, we made the crown of thorns, we did the when he was nailed. It was really a cool piece that they, our effects team had made for the cross, because it was kind of a retractable cross, so they could put him, raise him up on this, and then this, you know, there were silicone hands that had been made, there were, you know, CGI kind of played a part in it with, you know, the nails and different things. There's a lot of really subtle CGI. When people think of CGI, they think of Star Wars and all these, you know, spaceships and big special effects. But CGI can be really, really subtle as well. And so they did some of that for this film. Most of it was practical or physical effects. But I remember being behind the scenes and hearing other crew members talk about the crucifixion. Of course, they were not religious at all. And all, you know, and I remember listening to them just talk about what Christ had gone through or what he must have gone through, and they, you know, I wonder if they even picked up a Bible, because it was so off from what the account is. And that's what really got me thinking, is that, you know, people really don't know. People really don't know. And that's not a bad thing, because some people just have never been taught that. But it got me really thinking in that direction, that, you know what, I've spent all my time making, you know, rubber monsters and gory things, different character makeups, and that was fun. But there are people that are out in the world that can just, you know, that's not going to get people to heaven. And that's what really started getting me to think in the direction that I need to be doing something different. Not everyone does that. Not everyone has to do that. But that's what I chose to, you know, to start, the direction that I started going in. So this movie kind of indirectly was the thing that, I remember walking into the shop once when we were getting everything ready for this film, and someone had a compound, it was a gelatin effects appliance, but it was of a compound knee fracture where the bone is sticking out of the knee. And I said, what is this for? And they said, well, this is for the film. And I said, that's not even historically accurate, because I said there were no bones broken. And, you know, it ended up not making it, whether or not that was the make or break of it, I don't know. But they didn't, you know, they didn't use it for film. But that was really kind of the mentality of what we were dealing with, is that there are people that really didn't understand or know or read the account of, to me, I thought, okay, if people were not religiously minded, that's fine. But to me, I thought, you know, if even the ones who aren't that way, of any of the things religious pertaining to Jesus, that was the one thing that I thought at least they would have had a fundamental understanding of, is how he died and the crucifixion. But it wasn't that way. And it really was true to never, you know, to never just assume with people and be very sensitive to their backgrounds with it. But that's kind of what led me in the direction of wanting to preach. Next one. All right, this is what we did for Universal. It was a live, kind of a live stage thing. On the left is the original Phantom, or well, not the Phantom, but I think it is. The Phantom on the right, we're ranking them up for all the old Universal monsters. The werewolf was made, Frankenstein's monster was done. I was hired to come in and do the Phantom makeup. And so this was a prosthetic, big prosthetic mask that went over the top of his head, and then I had it painted up, and detail it and apply it and everything for the final photo shoot at Universal, because it was some anniversary that they were having and they wanted Lon Chaney's characters to really be portrayed prominently on this TV special, I guess, that they were having for it. Next one. All right, this is another project I did with Lucasfilm back in 2007. George Lucas was the Grand Marshal of the Rose Parade in Pasadena. And so Lucasfilm called me back and they said, hey, you know, George is going to be the Grand Marshal. We're doing some big Star Wars floats. Could you come in and do some of the makeups for the floats? Of course, it was really cool to me, you know, to be able to be involved with that. So I had a 3:30 a.m. makeup call. So we had to be there 3:30 in the morning, make people up, and then they bust them over to, from, I think we were staying at Universal, and then they bussed them over to Pasadena. Now, if you're familiar with Southern California, those two cities are not right next to each other. It was a little bit of a drive, but you know, getting ready for the Rose Parade, you can imagine the traffic. But it was kind of cool, because it's almost like the parting of the Red Sea, because you just saw everyone just kind of park for the buses that would be George Lucas's people that are going on these, you know, these different floats. But there's airbrushing one of the main characters that's been on the float, doing some last minute touch-ups and prosthetics and everything. And some of the characters were made up on the left hand side there. So it's just, there's a lot of different aspects with makeup. It's not just special effects. Sometimes it's just regular character makeup. Sometimes it's cosmetic makeup. I would do, you know, I've done makeup for just, you know, like Dave said, I've worked with Slash, just doing some cosmetic stuff or on-camera stuff for him. Some of the TV sportscasters for NBC, I've done just some on-camera stuff. And, you know, it's not bad, but, it, you know, the fun stuff was, for me, was fantasy makeup or horror makeup, just anything that you can alter the look and alter a situation in doing that. Next one, please. All right, this one I did right before I left Aladdin. Musical Spectacular was a big, I think it was a big $10 million production that Disney was doing in Southern California. This shows, I think, the genie makeup, and this shows the different stages of the genie makeup. I think it was 7 or 8 piece prosthetic, and so it had the cowl, the ears were separate pieces, the cowl came down with the nose, that was all one piece, and then the chin was one piece. And so, that's pretty normal for a bigger makeup. And then when we did Cat in the Hat, it was a big multi-piece prosthetic. And you do that so that it moves with the actor. Having just one solid piece that covers everything, you get some movement, but not a lot of movement. And so by doing these multiple pieces, he's able to be a lot more mobile, and people can tell facial expressions, along with other things. And so there's the final product or look with that you see at the bottom with the genie for Aladdin. Next one. All right, this is the last slide for this. I don't know how much time I have left, but okay. Anyone recognize this film? Van Helsing. This was one of the most fun films I think I had, that I did. And it was because it was monster making, which I absolutely loved. So we did a Frankenstein creature, full body suit, full prosthetic, full latex prosthetic on him. And he had the cowl on the top of his head for, to show the larger and large forehead and everything, and then the hands. And then we did the brides. You see at the bottom the prosthetic pieces that we had that we put on the brides. And so there was several characters. In fact, we did a lot of characters for Van Helsing, some that didn't even make the film. We did it. The director, I remember, wanted a whole fleet of zombies in the movie. So we did a whole bunch of zombie, foam latex zombie masks for these, for all of these different zombies. And then one day, just out of the blue, someone came in and they said, hey, the director's scrapping the zombies. So we had to destroy all the masks. And it happens a lot that, just last minute decision making like that, where you put in hours and hours and hours of work and then all to no avail. So, there's different things with makeup though. There's a lot of, but it was fun. It was a fun life. It was a crazy time just being able to do a lot of this. Met a lot of really good people. Everyone says, oh, who are some of the actors that you worked with? All right. So I've worked with, one of my favorites was Gary Oldman that I worked with, if you're familiar with Gary Oldman. We did a full body cast on Gary Oldman for a production. It was an independent movie, and he was in this weird kind of slouching position, and we did this, and he was really good to his makeup artist. So he stayed that way for probably over an hour so we could do the body cast on him. And he was the only actor that I knew that, there are chemicals that we work with in special effects sometimes. And so we got the highly flammable signs all over, no smoking, and here comes Gary in and just smoking a cigarette like it's nothing in the shop. So we're like, Gary, oh, sorry. But it was, but you do meet some really good people. People like Gunner, you meet Goodnight. All these films have all the different actors and filmmakers. And you're like a family during the process of it, and then you move on to the next one. But that's kind of what the background is. I don't think there's time for any questions or anything, but anyway, hopefully you enjoyed it. It's it's fun if you want to get into it. It's a fun hobby. It's an expensive hobby if you don't do it for a living. But it's but nonetheless, it's always a good time to kind of get you to go back and do it when you get a chance.